Americans like to think we invented democracy, or at least representational government. But in fact, the first parliament was held in England in 1258, hundreds of years before we were a twinkle in King George III's eye. And the interesting thing about that parliament was, it was not the king's idea at all. In fact, he was very much against it. His barons forced it on him. And the leading baron is a man named Simon de Montfort, who historians still argue about today. His motives, why, for the first time, he espouses the rights of common people. He takes away the rights, not just of the throne, but also of barons, about the right of common people to serve in Parliament. This morning's class moves just past where we ended last week. Last week we saw a king and his barons make very different decisions about power and authority. We saw a pope interfere with kings, their decisions, and their people. This was not unique to England or to France. The 1200s are an amazing time in history. Radical change was common, not what we think of when we think of the early Middle Ages. A great spiritual movement, second only to the Reformation in the 1500s, swept Europe. The followers of St. Francis and St. Dominic took their ideals and their ideas, not to the rich, but to the poor, for the first time. Among the new Franciscan friars who comes to England is a man named Roger Bacon. And he ends up teaching at Oxford, the new university at Oxford. The new order taught commoners to read and to write and to think. This is new, common people asking questions. They preach the rights and the worth of common people. Now today we like to say that education is a great leveler, that if you all have, or if you're all well educated, it's a flat playing field. We all have the same opportunities. To some extent that's true, but think about it from the viewpoint of somebody in the 1200s. You are the nobles, you are well educated. You already have a flat playing field. Suddenly, all your tenants are learning to read and write and asking questions. Education is as much an unleveler as it is a leveler, depending on which side of education you are when it occurs. Many of the people heard the Magna Carta read in shire courts and village greens. And the power of the Magna Carta was not so much in the fact that it restricted the authority of the king, but in the implied statement that all authority is restricted. And so the common people began to make demands and ask questions and want accountability from their own nobles, from their king, and from their popes. But the popes weren't paying attention. The popes of the 1200s and the 1300s are not good representatives as a whole of what they espoused. Instead, they are fighting for temporal power. There are a number of wars over land. Christians fight Christians, and they're not paying attention to the questions that people are asking. There's a fierce war in Europe between the Pope and Emperor Frederick over land. Not over faith, not even over ideas, strictly for control of land and the power of kings. Crusades were called, not against the Muslims who held Jerusalem, but against new Christian sects with their new ideas. So when King John was forced to sign the Magna Carta, it was natural for him to ask the Pope to help him. And Pope Innocent did. He annulled the Magna Carta in a letter dated 24 August 1215. But it does not make it to England until the end of September, and it's too late. The Magna Carta has been read throughout the country. The people know what it says, and they will not accept the annulment. And so civil war breaks out. The barons are worried. The barons who are fighting the king are worried. And so they go to the French king and they ask for troops and support. And they promise that if the French king will give them troops, they will name his son, Louis, King of England. And so the Dauphin Louis brings troops and he lands in Kent pretty well unopposed in May of 1216. And he marches to London pretty much unopposed. But there's a slight problem. The barons are happy to have him there, but to the common people, it's a foreign invasion, no matter how good the intent is. These people are foreigners. As we learned last week, John retreats to the fens, misjudges the tides, loses his jewels, catches a fever, and that, with the dysentery he already had, killed him. And so King John passes from history. There was some suspicion of poison, but no proof. So now the followers of John are kind of in a panic. John's son, Henry, is only 9 years old. And the barons who oppose him have promised Louis the throne. So what they need to do is have a crowned king. It's harder to depose a crowned king than it is to declare a new king when there is no crowned king. And so they rush the little 9-year-old boy and his mother, Isabella, to Gloucester. And they crown him, 28 October 1216. Now, there are no coronation robes. The crown jewels are somewhere in the swamps and fens. And so the little boy is crowned with one of his mother's torques, one of those stiff gold collars that women wore in those days. Isabella was not a popular queen. Nobody recommended that she be the regent for the 9-year-old boy. And so within a year, she goes back to France, to Angoulême. You may remember from last week, she was engaged when she met King John. And she disengages so she can marry the king. When she goes back to Angoulême as a widow, she marries her original fiancé. He ends up at war with France as well. He dies, and Isabella is accused of trying to poison the French king. Woman has an adventurous life. She has to flee for her life, and she goes to the abbey at Fontevrault and dies there in hiding in 1246. And that's hard to say. If you think I'm going to say that again, you're wrong. The new young king ends up with two co-regents, William Marshall and Hubert de Burgh, the justiciar. Now, William Marshall was a gallant, brave, experienced knight. He was a hero to the English people. He was popular and loyal. He had served Henry II, Richard, John, and now Henry III. The country is still at war. The French army is still there. They control London and most of southeast England. To win over the barons and public opinion, the regents, now with the Pope's approval, reissue the Great Charter with some changes. They reworded and deleted a number of clauses. Their explanation was, since some clauses in the former charter seemed weighty and doubtful, namely those clauses concerning scutages, forests, and rivers, those were put in respite until they can be discussed at a full council, until all the barons can come together. The clause establishing that 25-man watchdog committee is quietly omitted without a word. They do add two very interesting points, however. For the very first time, 21 is when heirs come of age. It dates back that far. And we're no longer talking guidelines. Remember, the original charter talked about guidelines for the king. In this charter, there are no longer guidelines. The 1216 charter clearly states the changes are enacted law. The Magna Carta is the law of the land. And they promise the 9-year-old king will rule by the amended charter. Now, they don't proclaim it until November, but that's because they're still at war. The young king affirms the new charter when he sits in a parliament, so to speak, but a major meeting of the nobles in Westminster later that year. He will reaffirm it a third time in 1225 when he's 17 and considered old enough to be part of government. The idea of a contract between king and subject, an idea that was first written by Alfred the Great, then Canute, and Æthelred the Unready, Anglo-Saxon kings, is now the basis of English law. It is to this day. When English law is gathered into a statute book 100 years later, the first statute, statute number one, is the 1225 version of the Magna Carta. It is absolutely the linchpin for English common law. William Marshall died in 1219. His replacement was a gentleman named Peter de Roche. Now, he's from Poitiers in Aquitaine. He's a bishop of Winchester. He's also weak and greedy. His advice to the young king will be equally bad. Henry is crowned a second time at Westminster on 17 May 1220. He wears all new coronation regalia, new crown, new robe, new scepter. Had to replace it. But he's only 12 years old, so the regency continues. Hubert de Burgh really struggles to replace William Marshall. He's an able soldier. He does a good job of controlling the still unruly barons. He uncovers a plot to kidnap the young king. But he's not much of a strategist, militarily or politically. And so he cannot hold on to the English property in France. And he loses Aquitaine and cannot seem to get it back. Only Gascony is left. In 1227, Henry, now 20, assumed the rule. Hubert de Burgh remains chief justiciar. But the next year, Henry demands money for another French campaign. The treasury is bare. And so in 1232, Hubert de Burgh is charged with stealing the money. Now, he didn't. It was all de Roche's idea. But it does create a political vacuum, which de Roche wanted. So with de Burgh disgraced, he recommends to the young king, well, you don't know your nobles very well. Why don't I pull in my friends and relatives from Poitiers? I know them. I can guarantee their service. All you have to do is agree to it. And I'll bring them here, and they can have all the powerful positions. And Henry agrees. The problem is Aquitaine and Poitiers are no longer English territory. And so the newcomers are considered foreigners, interlopers, taking those powerful positions. Richard William Marshall's son complains, and De Roche declares him a traitor. So Edmund Rich, Archbishop of Canterbury, with Richard Marshall, and a delegation of barons call on the king. They ask him to expel De Roche and all of his friends and family. Now, one of the things you will learn about Henry is he always agrees with whoever's standing there in front of him. And so Henry agrees. He should be learning the lesson his father John did not. You cannot afford to ignore the feelings of your most powerful subjects. But just as John did not learn it, Henry does not. The lesson sticks only for the moment, not for tomorrow. There are no portraits yet of kings. This is from a tapestry, and this is supposed to be the young Henry. The Benedictine monk and chronicler of the times, Matthew Paris, described Henry as of medium height and compact in body. One of his eyelids drooped, hiding some of the dark part of the eyeball. He had robust strength, but was careless in his acts. Oh, yeah. Henry married Eleanor, the daughter of Raymond Berenger, Count of Provence, on 14 January 1238. Eleanor's sister was married to the King of France. It's a powerful family. It's a good marriage. Eleanor was beautiful. She was called La Belle. And she brings with her, initially a small court, of poets and painters and musicians. Henry falls in love with everything French. And so he invites more nobles from Provence and from France to come to England. And he showers them with honors and land. Haven't we been here before? The barons are outraged. And Henry lets the new nobles do anything they want. When people complain, the new French nobility replies, "What have we to do with English law and custom?" Sounds like Edward the Confessor and his Normans, doesn't it? But then Edward the Confessor was Henry's hero, his model. Now, wasn't all bad? This influx of French culture sparks English culture, and it needed it. England had been renowned for some time, in fact, since Anglo-Saxon times, for the beauty of its tapestry and its weaving. But now English artists and writers emerge. Anglo-Saxon and Norman songs of war and adventure take on more sophisticated forms and subject matter. In fact, the stories of King Arthur develop into their final form during this time. And for the first time, we have the emergence of protest songs. Mostly political, many of them satire. But Henry's such a great subject for satire. And so most of them are about Henry. Henry would probably have been an architect had he not been king. And so a lot of the experts he calls in are architects and builders. Old churches are torn down, castles are revamped, new buildings come into the skyline of London, Winchester, Oxford. And they're all in the new Gothic style. Now, despite Henry's love of Edward the Confessor, in spite of the fact that he made Edward his personal saint, he decides he's going to tear down Westminster and replace it with a cathedral more in keeping with the glory of Henry and Edward. He has painters add murals of Anglo-Saxon life, Edward's time, on the walls of the new castle. That's not new, despite the fact that not a one of them married an Anglo-Saxon woman. Ever since the reign of Henry II in 1154, the kings have been claiming Anglo-Saxon roots. Unfortunately, we don't know how they did it, but it must have been an interesting, kind of convoluted claim. Henry names his firstborn Edward after Edward the Confessor, and he has a mural of Edward's life on his bedroom wall. First thing every morning, last thing every night, it's hello and good night to Edward. Now, Edward demolishes, as I said, the Westminster Cathedral, builds a new one, the one that we know today, with minor changes since then. He makes Westminster Hall and Palace the home of his family and his court. It is the seat of government and justice. For the first time in England, we now have a permanent, stable court. They're not, as they did in the last couple of weeks, they're not on horseback going from castle to castle. Now there's a place where the power mongers and the power brokers can congregate. Interestingly enough, when he finishes the central part of Westminster Cathedral, which is a monument to Edward the Confessor, he moves Edward's body into it. This is now the seat of government. At the heart of the seat of government is Edward the Confessor's body. And right beside it is Edward's wife, Edith. What makes it funny is, you all remember, Edward the Confessor worked so hard to keep the Godwins out of power. And now Henry, who idolizes Edward, without even thinking about it, brings Godwin's daughter into the heart of power. So he obviously didn't know as much about Edward as he thought he did. Now the councils that the Magna Carta said had to be held regularly are now held in Westminster instead of at different places in the country. And the barons, as they come, each time they're called into council, they're madder, angrier, and they're bolder. And they get closer and closer to demanding an accounting of the projects and the buildings that Henry calls them to pay for. Because you already have to call the council, the barons, together if you're going to raise taxes, because that's where the money comes from. And so when they come, they know he's going to ask for taxes. And every time they come, they're a little bit closer to saying, not till you ante up and explain to us the policies and the programs that this money will support. The problem is that Henry's rubbing their nose in it every time he calls the council meetings in Westminster, because they're looking at this building in progress every time he calls them. The rebuilding of Westminster Cathedral took 39 years and 46,000 pounds. In today's dollars, it's a lot of zeros. And so every time they come, they're looking at this and thinking, this is not what I want my taxes to go for. Edward the Confessor paid for the original cathedral out of his own pocket. Henry expects taxes to pay for the new building, and he didn't ask anybody about it before he started. The barons threaten to withhold money. We will not pay you. This is the first time we know that people are experimenting with the golden rule. You know the golden rule. He who has the gold makes the rules. They're not yet parliaments, but the word parliament is beginning to be used in the 1230s. Across London, Henry is also building. He put the wall, that huge strong wall around the Tower of London, Wakefield Tower inside, and he's the one who builds the menagerie inside. In case you haven't guessed by now, building, architecture, and Edward the Confessor are Henry's passions. He is the first king pictured doing something other than fighting, being crowned, or praying. And Henry is often depicted meeting with masons and builders. He's the architect, the master builder, and all these people are running around building because Henry is having them do it. Henry had reaffirmed the amended Magna Carta 3 times, but he's not paying attention to it. He is not ruling according to it as he promised, especially when it comes to taxes. And you remember the barons put a lot of tax relief in the Magna Carta. Henry is even bringing back scutage. And that is the tax the barons must pay in lieu of military service. Worst of all, when he put scutage back in place, he does not use the money for military campaigns. So he's taking taxes under false pretenses. Queen Eleanor was also ticking off the barons. She was too expensive. More and more people are coming from Provence. The court is more expensive every year. Now, since Anglo-Saxon times, all the cargoes that were unloaded at the quay known as Queen Tithe in London paid a toll that went to the Queen. That's how she supported her court. Eleanor has a growing court. She needs more money. She starts forcing the ship owners, especially the ones bringing in the expensive cargoes, to land only at her quay. So she gets the money. Eleanor's expense list is still available to us. We know what she was asking for money to do. And on it is 4,017 pounds for secret gifts and alms. She was charging people, the ship owners who had to unload at her quay, the money they paid her, she used for charity. So she's charging the people for her charitable amounts. And they knew it. And they got angrier and angrier. And then Henry levied a new 4-pound-a-day tax on the city of London to support a new white bear that he had added to his menagerie. Pork barrel funding is not a 20th century invention. Now, Henry is out asking for military funds. You would think he would be a soldier. Henry is a terrible soldier, but he is a good negotiator. He does negotiate some of the best treaties in English history. The Treaty of York with Scotland in 1237 established a strong alliance with Scotland and more or less established the same boundaries between the two countries that we have today. The Treaty of Woodstock in 1247 with Wales did exactly the same thing. In 1250, Henry announces he's going on crusade. More scutage has to be paid, but he does not go on crusade. There was trouble in the papacy again, or maybe still. And in 1254, the Pope convinced Henry to use the money he had gathered to go on crusade to support the Pope's war in Sicily. A man named Manfred had seized Sicily from the Pope, and the Pope wanted it back. So he told Henry, if you'll use that money and your troops and help me take Sicily back, I will make your second son, Edmund, king of Sicily. Edward agreed. The barons are even more upset. They don't even know where Sicily is. If France is now a foreign country, Sicily's on the backside of beyond. You know, all this just to make his second son a king of some country they don't even know about. Henry takes troops and money to Sicily. It is not a completely successful campaign. So in 1266, the French join in the battle for Sicily. They do win Sicily back, and the Pope makes Charles of Anjou king of Sicily, not Edmund. As far as the barons are concerned, Henry is John all over again. He taxes them unjustly. He wastes resources in foreign wars. He gives away land without fighting for it. He's got all these foreign advisors. What's different? But more than the barons are unhappy now. Just as several of the archbishops had brought along talented commoners to serve them under Henry II's reign, now we have a growing number of cathedral schools and those two universities at Oxford and Cambridge. And they're turning out highly educated, very ambitious young men, mostly commoners, who are going into the church and into the new government offices. And they're looking around, and they're there because of the Magna Carta. They're there because of the new spirit of law and government. And how long is that going to last? How long are their jobs going to last if King Henry continues to ignore the Magna Carta? And so people begin to even talk about maybe it's time to bring back that watchdog committee, the clause that was dropped quietly from the 1215 Magna Carta. By 1258, the kingdom was almost bankrupt. The previous year's harvest had failed. Famine was everywhere. Matthew Paris described it, Owing to the shortage of food, an innumerable multitude of poor people died, and dead bodies were found everywhere, swollen through famine and livid, lying in fives and sixes, in pigsties and dunghills in the muddy streets. 28 April, 1258, seven barons, led by Richard de Clare, Earl of Gloucester, Roger Bigod, Earl of Norfolk, and Simon de Montfort, Earl of Leicester, ride to Winchester, fully armed. They clank into the castle. They do leave their swords by the door as they go into the main hall to greet Henry. Now, you remember Henry and that great backbone he has, right? Okay. They tell Henry they've come to free him from his corrupt foreign council. Matthew Paris tells us Henry responded. He acknowledged the truth of the accusations and humbled himself, declaring that he had too often been beguiled by evil counsel, and made a solemn oath at the shrine of St. Edward that he would fully and properly amend his old errors and show favor and kindness to his native-born subjects. Anybody want to buy a bridge? A sullen Henry also agrees to a parliament at Oxford. 12 of his supporters, 12 of his barons, and 12 representatives chosen by the barons themselves will meet. The purpose was to decide how our kingdom shall be ordered, rectified, and reformed in keeping with what they think best to enact. Henry makes the same mistake the Confederation Congress made in 1787. He's too vague in his instructions. On 11 June 1258, the 24 men met at Oxford. They produce a document called the Provisions of Oxford. It transferred a great deal of Henry's power to a council of barons, 15 of them, and only 3 can be chosen by the king, by Henry. The other 12 are chosen by the barons themselves. They are reinstating the watchdog committee from the Magna Carta. The council would appoint the great offices of state, control the exchequer, supervise the sheriffs and local officials, and advise the king in good faith regarding the government of the kingdom. And they called the kingdom a community of the realm, communitas regni. On the local level, 4 elected knights in each shire would be responsible for collecting complaints and grievances and delivering them to the justiciar. And the justiciar is now sort of the attorney general for the country. Sheriffs would be selected from the local community. The king cannot appoint them from other shires. They will be put on salary and will serve for only 1-year terms. Pretty amazing, huh? And the king's foreign favorites got their eviction notices. Go home. Simon de Montfort told one, "You will either lose your castles or lose your heads. Your choice." Think about this. This is 1258. 1258. And they're asserting the right to approve the king's appointments, review the funding for his projects, veto them if necessary. Sound familiar? And it's 1258. The Provisions of Oxford go on to say the king's sovereignty is conditional on his accountability to the representatives of the community of the realm and his ability to guarantee the well-being of all his people. The Provisions of Oxford are a breathtaking leap toward a constitutional monarchy and it's 1258. Now, we think we have divisions and problems between conservatives and liberals today. Can you imagine the impact when the Oxford provisions get out and people everywhere are reading them? People were probably hyperventilating all over the country. Where did this come from? But the provisions of Oxford also did something unprecedented. They introduced the concept of an English state, a community of the realm. It's the birth of nationalism, the idea that a people and a place constitute an identity. They also spark a powerful reform movement, the most radical until the English Civil Wars of the middle 1600s. Now, the commons play no part in writing the provisions of Oxford. Those 24 men were the only ones involved in the writing of it. But outside, the people of Oxford know what's going on. People inside taking notes come out and talk to them. And so there are parades, there are speeches, there are bonfires in support of the provisions. The people are aware. They're no longer just the victims. They are at least active observers. Henry, of course, did not appreciate the provisions of Oxford. His reaction was very much like his father's with the Magna Carta. Why don't they take my kingdom? He will not go quietly. The more they push, the more he clings to his traditional power. His oldest son, Prince Edward, also rails against the Oxford provisions. But in time, both are forced to sign them. The provisions of Oxford were proclaimed in Latin, French, and English. A copy of the English text was sent to every sheriff in every shire with instructions to read it 7 times a year so every man will understand them. Many of the nobles of the realm join in the reform, and for the first time, so do many of the clergy. Most notably, Walter de Canaloup, Bishop of Worcester, and the Franciscan scholar, Adam Marsh. The man who eventually, though, leads the reform and who has come down through history as the absolute model for uncompromising English resolve is Simon de Montfort. And a more unlikely reformer you will not find. He's not even English. He's every bit as foreign as the foreigners the barons just kicked out of the country. His father, also named Simon, was a fanatic, a crusader against other Christians. The elder Simon fought to support papal bulls. His son fights to support the Magna Carta and the freedom of common people. They're not even on the same planet. Simon is complex. He's contradictory. He's very human. He gives his life for the rights of common people. He becomes their voice. And yet at the same time, he allows his family to fatten on the lands of his enemies. And so historians have a great deal of trouble with Simon. But he's human. But let's spend a little time with this most unlikely reformer. The de Montfort family took their name from a hill between Paris and Chartres called Montfort-la-Marie. And I've got that written here somewhere for you, I think. Nope, didn't. Okay. Their connection to England began during the reign of King Henry II with our Simon's grandfather. You remember Henry II married Eleanor of Aquitaine, the former wife of the King of France. And the two men fought over a lot of land, Aquitaine, Normandy, Anjou. And the elder Simon, grandfather Simon, had land in Aquitaine, which belonged to Henry II, and in France, near Paris, which belonged to the King of France. Now, a lot of families were in that same situation, and when war broke out between the two kings, they lost out because they chose one side or the other, and they ended up much poorer after the wars were settled. Our grandfather, Simon, was a very, well, he was a master manipulator, let's just put it that way. And he worked both sides. He kept his land under the King of France, kept his land in Aquitaine, and even married Amicia de Beaumont, the sister and co-heir of Robert, Earl of Leicester, an English noble. Earl Robert died in 1204 without children, the title of Earl of Leicester, and half of the possessions of the earldom passed to Amicia's second son, also called Simon. It would have helped so much in reading history if they would have changed their names more often. You notice that? This Simon, the father of our reformer, was a very strange man, a mixture of adventurer, statesman, and fanatic. He was a zealot who made his fortune attacking, sacking, and destroying the Christian enemies of the Pope. And there were a number of new Christian sects popping up here and there in Europe. And the popes declared crusade against them. They were heretics because they did not follow the party line. And Simon goes from one to the other, attacking them. He's most famous for being really the death of the Cathar sect in France, in southern France. There is a book, The Perfect Heresy, by Stephen O'Shea, that covers the battles that ended in the genocide of the Cathars. And Simon, the elder Simon, is a great part of that. He's not an easy man to like. In fact, you don't like him, but he is a fascinating character. The older Simon marries Alice de Montmorency. Alice was as deeply pious as her husband, and she accompanied him on most of his campaigns. And we don't know much about Alice. At least three French chroniclers mention her, but all three of them use very strange language, and I'll share with you one of them. One chronicler said her religion adorned her wisdom and diligence. Her diligence exercised her religion and wisdom. I can't get anything human out of that. There's no personality there. It's very cold and very structured. And all three statements are very similar. Now, it's dangerous to make extrapolations based on just three statements, but you don't get much feeling that was a warm, loving mother. In 1210, King John took the earldom of Leicester away from Dad Simon. He had cause. The older Simon was fighting with King John's brother-in-law at the time. It's a good enough excuse. Not that kings needed that much excuse in those days. Simon was doing well in his papal war, so the loss of the English lands was not major. He did keep the title. He still called himself the Earl of Leicester. When Simon died, so did control of all the land that the popes had allowed him to gather up. It reverted to the papacy. And so for his sons, Amari and Simon, the loss of the English lands is now a pretty major event. Henry III is now King of England and in his everything French phase. And so Amari petitions for the return of the earldom of Leicester. As much as Henry loved France and everything French, he did not want divided loyalties among his nobles. And so he tells Amari, you can have it back, but you have to renounce your French lands, and you have to be my man. Well, Amari was French. He didn't want to give up his French lands. So instead of claiming Leicester, he renounced his claim in favor of his younger brother, Simon. Simon was a teenager at the time, so for a few years, he doesn't claim the land either. Simon was the youngest of seven children. He was born in 1208 and brought up in the castle of Montfort. We know absolutely nothing about his childhood. We do know his parents were not there very often. Both of them were mostly off on campaign. We don't know who raised him. We don't know how he was educated. We do know that in 1229 or 1230, he joined in a baron's revolt against Queen Blanche of France. She was the regent for her son, Louis. And the barons thought she was abusing them, and so they start a war with her. Blanche wins, and the young Simon has to escape to England. Henry receives him kindly, and on 18 August 1231, Simon did homage to the English king for the earldom of Leicester. And so Simon de Montfort is now Earl of Leicester. Simon was described as handsome, charismatic, strong, skilled in tactics and strategy. Not bad for somebody only 23 years old. He was intense, compelling. When he talked, you kind of focused on him. You couldn't seem to take your eyes away. Very self-confident, but hot-tempered, and could be easily pushed all the way to arrogance. There was no do not pass go, do not collect $200 block on his board. The English baron suspected their new peer of being an adventurer, overly ambitious. He was poor and foreign. But then few people are ever neutral about Simon. To this day, English historians are still not neutral. They're either very pro-Simon or very anti-Simon. Simon evidently courted two very wealthy French heiresses unsuccessfully. But on January the 7th, 1238, he privately married King Henry's 23-year-old sister, Eleanor, in the King's Chapel. Henry gave the bride away. He even gave up her dowry. But there's a slight problem. Eleanor was a widow. She married William Marshall when she was 9 and he was 40. When he died, the 16-year-old widow made a vow she would never marry again. She made the vow in front of the Archbishop of Canterbury. Now she's 23 and she's remarried. The barons and the church have a fit. Any royal marriage affects the succession. And Henry has no children yet. The barons say we should have been consulted, and it wouldn't have been to allow her to marry some foreigner. The Archbishop of Canterbury declares the marriage is a crime. She's breaking her vow. Many people just refuse to even call her by her new name. If we just ignore this, maybe the whole thing will go away. Simon begs and borrows enough money to go to Rome and meet with the Pope. We don't know what he said, but he convinced Pope Gregory the Ninth to grant him a dispensation for the marriage. The English clergy are stunned. Matthew Paris wrote, "The court of Rome reasoned somewhat more subtle than it is given us to understand." But King Henry does have a son and takes Simon out of the direct line of succession. His first son, Edward, is born on 17 June 1239. Henry announced the glad tidings and expected a lot of baby gifts to come in. Okay? Any gift he thought was too small or too cheap, he sent back with a snotty note saying, "Try again." A jester reportedly said, "God has given us this child, but the king sells him to us." Simon was one of 9 godfathers to the new young prince, I'm sorry. King Henry later stands godfather for Simon's second son, named Henry for the king. But Henry and the king soon quarrel. We don't know exactly over what. Could have been money. Simon did owe Henry some money. Could have been new papal bulls that Simon did not agree with. Could just have been jealousy. But there's major trouble. A furious and spiteful Henry accuses Simon of dishonor, saying he consented to the marriage between Simon and his sister Eleanor only because Eleanor was pregnant. He also rejects the Pope's dispensation and seizes the couple's home in London. So Simon and Eleanor leave for France and Simon's family. Simon never trusts Henry again. Many of the meetings between the two men thereafter are stand-up shouting matches. But the relationship between the two men is not the normal king and subject relationship. But for the time being, Eleanor and Simon have to leave the country. Now, however the English church may have reacted to the marriage, Simon has one very good friend in the church, a gentleman named Robert Grostest, Bishop of Lincoln. Simon obviously valued their friendship. He kept a large number of the letters that they exchanged. Many historians think it is Grostest and his influence that changes Simon from a normal, think for yourself, baron, to so improbably a voice for the common people. Simon saved, as I said, many of the letters. He writes notes on them, comments. He even has one dated in 1238 that's discussing a case that Simon judged at Leicester, and Grostest thinks he was too harsh. Simon admires and respects him enough to take criticism from him. Now, he sends Simon a letter of condolence for the exile. On 1 April 1240, Simon returns to England to gather supplies and men for a crusade. The fickle Henry welcomes him as if nothing has happened. But Simon joins the Pope's enemy, Frederick II, on crusade. Frederick was king of Sicily, emperor of Germany, and controlled much of Italy. Frederick was a true free thinker, the Pope said, an unbeliever. He was a scholar, a soldier, and way too powerful for the Pope's comfort. Frederick may also have influenced Simon's evolution. The two-year war in the Holy Land changed Simon. He returned deeply pious, often getting up at midnight and spending the rest of the night in vigil. He seeks out the great thinkers of England, his friend Robert Grostest, of course, but also Walter de Canaloupe and the scholar monks Roger Bacon and Adam Marsh. All four men supported the idea of a government based on charity, justice, and clemency. Before he died, Grostest wrote a treatise defining both a just rule and a tyranny. And it talks about injustice on the national scale. Simon has known personal injustice during the Barons' Revolt, certainly from Henry. Almost without a doubt, he saw it on crusade. Somehow he makes the jump from personal injustice to political injustice. And that's a jump that's hard to make. Most of us don't do it. In 1247, Henry made Simon governor of Gascony. It's the last bit of French territory Henry owns. The country was in turmoil, and the wine wasn't coming in like it should have been. So Simon found that the nobles in Gascony were abusing their people. And so he supports the people against the nobles. He applies justice so strictly, the Gascon nobles rebel and complain to Henry. They're not used to being on the other end of justice. Henry has Simon arrested and put on trial for treason. He He accuses Simon of overstepping his authority and provoking the rebellion in Gascony. Simon tells Henry, "That word is a lie, and were you not my sovereign, it would be an ill hour for you when you dared utter it." Not exactly what you expect a subject to say to a king, but they have a very strange relationship. Simon is acquitted, and he becomes more popular with the English nobles. The trial was so obviously put on. King Henry liked and feared Simon, hated and respected him, sometimes all at the same time. One of the stories that they tell to illustrate that point is that Henry was rowing on the Thames when a thunderstorm came up. Henry ordered the boat to the nearest pier, which happened to be next to a house where Simon de Montfort was staying. Simon came out to assure the king, "The storm's over, you're okay." And Henry is supposed to have said, "I fear the thunder and lightning exceedingly, but I fear you even more." Still, with all that, Henry gives Simon the strongest, most impenetrable royal castle in the country, Kenilworth Castle. Simon and Eleanor set up their own court at Kenilworth Castle. They call in the great minds, the great artists of the day. Simon adopts fully the identity and the ideals of England. And so he's one of the nobles who forced Henry to call that meeting at Oxford. He's one of the prime players in writing of the Provisions of Oxford. But during the debates that resulted in the Provisions of Oxford, somebody asked a very, very dangerous question. How widely do the Magna Carta and the proposed provisions apply? Now, there's absolutely no doubt that the nobles can call the king to account. The Magna Carta says so. They may bring grievances to the king and call him to account. In the new provisions of Oxford that they're drafting, it's very clear that freemen can also bring their grievances to the king and call the king to account. Nobody has a problem with that. The question that is so dangerous is, do we take it a step further? Do these new provisions in the Magna Carta also mean that free men can call barons to account? How far down does accountability, how far down does the application go? Is the entire hierarchy of authority subject to constraint and accountability? It's a question we're still asking today, and they ask it in 1258. And Simon de Montfort says, yes, the nobles need the same constraints as the king. He understands what our founding fathers fought over in writing our Constitution. Power will corrupt, not may will. And balance is necessary. Accountability is necessary. That day's meeting ends in outrage and shouting. But the final provisions include the ordinance of the magnates that limits baronial power. Some of the reformers, notably the Earl of Gloucester, refuse to sign them. They will not be accountable. It's okay to limit the king's power. It is not okay for their tenants to call them to account. And they pull out. Simon de Montfort calls them fickle and deceitful. And as we know, a reluctant king and Prince Edward sign the provisions. After his first fury at being forced to sign them, Prince Edward wavers a little bit. For a short period of time, he follows Simon. He's caught by that charisma, that charm. He's fascinated by his ideas. And he agrees with Simon. If the king must answer to the wrongs of his tenants, that is, the barons, then the barons must answer to the wrongs of their tenants, the freemen. If we are going to do that, it must cover everybody. And Prince Edward agrees. Now, Edward was impatient with his father and his father's foreign advisors. He was glad to see them go. But he wants more power. Like Henry II's sons, Edward wants some of his father's power. But Edward is going to be one of England's more complex and ruthless kings. His motivations are never simple, and so we're never quite sure where he's coming from. It's fairly clear Simon de Montfort fascinated him, but Edward would never willingly give up even an ounce of power. He listens to both sides and then begins to pull the people to him that are disaffected from his father and from Simon. He's creating a third party, so to speak. Now, King Henry is not laying down under this either. He works a deal with the King of France. He gives the King of France Gascony, his last piece of France, in return for money and influence with the Pope. And in 1261, Henry renounced the Oxford Provisions. And he receives a special papal bull absolving him from his oath. The Pope says, you're not accountable for making that promise. First Pope Alexander IV and then Urban IV excuse Henry from those oaths. A backlash is also forming among the nobles. Changes came too fast and went too far for a lot of them. We humans like our change slow. We get very uncomfortable when change comes too fast. So now the papal bull gives the ones who are uncomfortable permission and reason to go back on Henry's side. Well, if the Pope says this wasn't right, then obviously we should go back. Turmoil sets in throughout the country. Henry starts to relieve the barons' officials all over the country. Some of them refuse to give up. And they are besieged in their own fortresses. Henry has used that money from the French king to hire mercenaries. So there are mercenary forces besieging Englishmen in their own castles. The shires are also in turmoil. They don't know what laws to follow. Some of them keep to the provisions of Oxford and defy the royal sheriffs. Others revert to the original laws. So from shire to shire now, you have different laws in effect. Henry II, who established that common law, was doing somersaults in his grave. Simon de Montfort demands the reinstatement of the provisions of Oxford. But Simon makes things worse. He scares off even some of the moderates because he's gone even farther with his thoughts. He doesn't just want everyone in the hierarchy accountable. He now says that the common people have the same right of representation as the nobles do. Government is a common enterprise. If it is a community of the realm, the common people have an equal role to play. It's an amazing leap in thought. He even writes public letters to the citizens of London, the church, and freemen in the shires. He acknowledges their political power, their right to a say in government. And it scares the tar out of a lot of people. If it was too far before, it's way too far, even for some moderates. Many of the people are for him, but not all. It's too far for some of them, too. They're not ready. The nobles are definitely divided. Some think he's the ultimate crusader for justice and for right. Others think he's Caesar, going to take over and strip us of our rights. Between 1263 and 1265, civil war breaks out across the country. By the end of 1263, Simon and his followers have London, then they lose it, and most of southeastern England. King Henry needs more mercenaries, and he needs money to buy them. They don't come cheap. And so Henry's queen, Eleanor, pawns some of her jewels, her royal jewels, to the Knights Templar. You loan us some money based on my jewels. Prince Edward either talks his way in or breaks into the Knights Templar temple, breaks open the treasure chests, and takes the jewels back and anything else that was in the treasure chests. So now the royal family can buy more mercenaries if they can find anybody willing to take the jewels in pawn again, which they probably couldn't. And he's made formidable enemies. The Knights Templar are not good enemies to have. And more immediately, he's got a problem because the mayor of London and the leading citizens of London are outraged by this act. They may not agree, they may not believe everything Simon de Montfort says, but he hasn't stolen any jewels. And so the people demonstrate in the streets against the royal family. Now, Queen Eleanor was never a popular queen. They were taxed personally, the people of London were taxed personally for that very expensive court of hers, of foreigners no less. And so anytime she goes out, somebody's usually hollering at her. But with these demonstrations, she takes fright, and she and her ladies decide they need to get out of London. And so they get on a barge to go down the Thames. People standing on London Bridge pelt her and her ladies with sheep bones and rotten eggs and manure from a variety of sources. The Queen, now a little stinky, takes refuge in St. Paul's Cathedral. Prince Edward is furious, and he vows revenge on the people of London. The Civil War heats up. More of the people of the country are going to Simon's side. The two forces meet in a battle in the Sussex Downs in a place near Lewes, L-E-W-E-S, on 14 May 1264. Simon came to the battle on a cart. He had broken his leg in a riding accident just a few days before. The king's forces far outnumber the rebels. In addition to mercenaries, King Henry had called in troops from Ireland and Scotland and Wales based on those treaties that he had signed. Among the Scottish mercenaries is the father of the future king, Robert the Bruce. The rebels are short of cavalry and experience. One whole wing is untested Londoners. Some of the more experienced nobles had left Simon and returned to the king's side. For at least four of them, the decision was devastating. Father will face son across the battle lines. Several of the family, leaders of the realm are on both sides. And several of the followers on Simon's side carry names that appeared on the Magna Carta. It's a horrible split with the nobility facing each other. Simon is a talented and experienced general. He contacts local men of Sussex. He wants them to be guides and scouts for him across those fens and swamps. The men of Sussex flock to Simon. Their Earl de Warenne is a king's man. But for the first time since the Norman invasion, the people are choosing which side they will support. With the Sussex guides, the rebels pull an all-night march to take the high ground outside Lewes. On the morning of the battle, Simon tells his men they're fighting for the kingdom of England and for the honor of God. Simon's men called themselves the Army of God, which is another of those very eerie parallels to the civil wars in the mid-1600s. And we'll cover that in classes 7 and 8. Simon orders his men to lie face down on the ground with their arms spread out to pray. And when they stand up, they put surcoats over their armor. And on the front and the back are the big white crosses of the crusaders. Now, the cross serves two purposes. One, it's a very powerful image, of course. But two, remember, they're facing their own. The people facing them speak the same language. They look the same. They dress the same. These are friends. And so the white cross on the front and back identifies friend from foe. So you know who to fight and who not to fight. It's a very critical issue. Even in modern warfare today, friend and foe identification is a crucial element, especially in a civil war. Prince Edward commands one of the royal flanks. He is face to face with that wing of Londoners. And he has vowed revenge for his mother's poop pelting. And here they are right in front of him. He's overconfident and he's inexperienced. Prince Edward launches an all-out attack, a charge on the Londoners. Well, these people have never fought before in their lives. They break and run. And Edward orders his people to chase them. And so they go tearing across the countryside, cutting the Londoners down as they run from them. What he also does is leave that side of the royal army unprotected. When he has satisfied his revenge and he comes back, the battle is over. It was a rout, but not the one he expected. The royals have lost. King Henry has taken refuge in the abbey at Lewes. All of his commanders are either dead or captured. Prince Edward becomes a hostage for the king's good conduct. If I were Edward, I would have been very worried. Henry is not a man whose good conduct you can count on. But the next 18 months are all the implementation of the rebels' ideas. For 18 months, England is almost a republic, and it's 1264. The new rules say Parliament must be called 3 times a year now, not just when the king wants it, but 3 times a year regardless. Now, the last time Parliament met, King Henry got in big trouble. So now King Henry says, I'm leaving the country. You won't be able to call a Parliament. And Simon answers, go. If you're here or not, we're having a Parliament. Can you imagine in 1264 telling a king he's no longer necessary? So Henry stays. He's not leaving the country under these conditions. And now more than nobles are called to Parliament. 2 knights of the shire, that is 2 large landowners from each shire, elected by their own people, not by outsiders, not selected by the barons, will represent the shire. And 2 burgesses from each of the chartered towns. These are tradesmen and merchants from the large chartered towns of Lincoln and York and London will all sit in Parliament as equals to the barons. For the first time in history, common men, unlanded men, will sit shoulder to shoulder with nobles, with the large landowners. At the same time, they will be looking at the same issues of government. Not even in Greek time did unlanded men sit side by side with landed men. It's not the House of Commons, but it's close. For the 1200s, very close. And this parliament is called the Great Parliament. Not for what it achieved, but for the precedent that it set. Simon de Montfort is called the father of Parliament. One modern historian, he's got a book on your list, said the new parliament introduced the union between patriotism and insubordination. For anyone who has seen the House of Commons in operation will understand exactly what that phrase means. They have it down to a science. Simon releases Prince Edward conditionally. He swears an oath to be good and stay within Simon's control. Now, you know and I know who we're talking about here. It does not sound like a real smart thing to do, and it wasn't. Edward's supporters get word to him. They have troops nearby. On 20 May 1264, he escapes. Neither Henry nor Edward ever seemed to think they had to keep their word, whether it was forced or given freely. Personally, by this time, I don't know why anybody asked them to promise anything, but they did. King Henry is pretty useless by now, but Edward serves as a strong rallying point for the royalist forces. An army forms around him, and Edward has learned from the Battle of Lewes. He will no longer let his passions rule. Edward takes command of the king's troops. He captures part of the rebel army in Gloucester. He surprises another army outside Kenilworth. The younger Simon, the son of our Earl, had been gathering troops to bring to his father. Edward surprises them and takes them all. The younger Simon escapes by swimming across the lake. But two-thirds of the rebel army are now gone. Simon and a much smaller rebel group is camped outside the Abbey of Evesham. Edward marches on the abbey under the de Montfort banners that he captured at Kenilworth. And he gets too close before they identify him. They think he's the younger Simon coming with the troops. When they finally realize he's Edward, a herald rushes in to tell Simon, "It's Edward, it's not your son." And Simon answers, "God have mercy on our souls, for our bodies are theirs." They are massively outnumbered and unready. The Battle of Evesham is more a massacre than a battle. Son Henry de Montfort dies in front of his father. Guy de Montfort is wounded, he's captured, he will later escape to France. The knights pledged to Simon's protection are all killed. Simon is unhorsed and killed. Edward, who never cared much about chivalry, looses his knights. 30 rebel knights, already wounded and on the ground and helpless, are killed. Some are mutilated so badly they are never identified. The royalist forces trampled them into the ground with their war horses. There wasn't even enough of their surcoats to identify who they were. Simon's head, his hands, his feet, and other body parts are cut off. Later, his hands, feet, and head are sent to different cities as proof he's dead and as a warning to other rebels. The monks at Evesham Abbey take his torso, that's all that's left, and bury it under the stones of the chapel. They don't identify where because they know it'll be dug up and further mutilated. King Henry and Prince Edward will punish the abbey severely for doing so. Thousands of people over the next couple of years make pilgrimage to Evesham. There are stories of cures and miracles. Songs break out in every tavern about Simon, his courage, and his vision. Anyone associated with Simon is arrested and disinherited. Land is taken from them. Nearly half the nobility is either dead or disinherited, driven from their lands. It's a sad repeat of the Norman invasion. Pope Clement removes the four bishops who traveled with Simon's army from office. They're defrocked. King Henry demands that the mayor and the leading citizens of London come to him, and he promises them safe passage, you know, safe conduct. They come, he arrests them anyway, he takes their land and punishes the city of London. It is fined, and they lose a large number of their charter rights over the next couple of years. It looks like the war will continue, and so Simon's wounded and captive knights begin to disappear across England. Monks and the common people are helping them escape and hide, going into either safety or exile across the sea. There were other rebels who had not made it to Evesham. They also go into hiding or into exile. Many of them gather at Kenilworth Castle. Others take refuge on the Isle of Ely. You remember the Isle of Ely, that's where Hereford the Wake held off William the Conqueror for so long. It's in the fens of Anglia, East Anglia. Edward lays siege to Kenilworth Castle. For 5 months in 1266, the besiegers pounded the walls. 9 catapults sent stones against the walls and dead animals into the keep. It is medieval biological warfare. You send dead animals into the keep, hoping they will spoil food, spoil water, and spread disease. It worked. There were a number of diseases running rampant among the besiegers. The besiegers gathered up any stones that made it inside the keep and threw them back. They had a couple of catapults, too. And so they're exchanging rocks. During part of the assaults, so many stones were catapulted, they were colliding in midair. Yes, it is. It is true. It is a documented fact. The Pope sends his legate to try to bring peace. The country is beggared. The defenders refuse. They're not ready to give up yet. They send the royal herald back to Prince Edward and the legate, minus a hand. The hand he had used to throw the peace treaty at the rebel leaders. He came in rather insolent. Things are really rough enough, violent enough, vicious enough, that they cut his hand off and sent him back without his hand in their refusal. The legate excommunicated them. He stands before the gates and he excommunicates solemnly the besiegers. The besiegers inside Kenilworth hold a mock excommunication on the walls. They excommunicate the legate and Prince Edward. There is nothing as vicious as a civil war. But over the dreary months, even Edward's bloodlust cools and his father relents. The kingdom is bankrupt. The people are sullen and uncooperative. They can't afford more vengeance. By December 1266, the defenders of Kenilworth use up all their fuel and all their food. They are freezing and starving to death. Edward offers terms. They're strict, but for Edward, probably he thought they were lenient. Kenilworth's commander would be imprisoned at Edward's desire, no more than a year, he promised. And he would pay 7 years' worth of income on his land. The common soldiers would be allowed to go free. All of the remaining knights and nobles would pay 5 years' combined income on their land. The dictum to Kenilworth offers the same deal to all Simon de Montfort's followers. Depending on their involvement, they will pay between 1 and 7 years' total income on their lands, and then their lands will be theirs again, free and clear. It is poverty for a number of years, but it does put the country back on its feet. It puts the nobles back on their land. It puts the farmers and the yeomen back farming. The rubbles in the fens of Ely hold out longer. It's harder to control access to swamplands and fens. And it's easier to get food and murky water anyway. But on 11 July 1267, the men at Ely finally accept the Kenilworth offer as well. Simon's sons, of course, do not get the offer. Simon's widow, Prince Henry's sister Eleanor, and her younger children had already escaped to France. Henry died at Evesham. Simon and Guy join her in France. King Henry III is 60 and beginning to suffer from dementia. The 26-year-old Prince Edward is in control of the country. Edward's victory over Simon at Evesham and over the rebels at Kenilworth Castle in Ely does not stop the reforms. For all his violence, Edward is a smart man, and he liked some of Simon's ideas. His opposition was personal. He did not want anyone else telling him what to do. We all know people like that. Some of you may be like that. In 1267, at the Parliament of Marlborough, Edward put some of the provisions of Oxford into statute. He is making them the law of the land. He also reaffirmed the Magna Carta with one interesting Simon de Montfort-like addition. Chapter 5 of the Statute of Marlborough says, "The Great Charter shall be observed in all the articles as well, in such as pertain to the king as to others." The barons are now accountable too. The point they broke with Simon over, that they would be accountable to their tenants as the king was accountable to them, is now the law of the land. Simon de Montfort left no heirs, direct heirs to history. Simon and his sons, Simon and Amaury, died fighting in France. Henry died, of course, at Evesham. Guy died in Sicily, ironically fighting for the Pope. Daughter Eleanor married Prince Llewellyn of Wales. She died in childbirth. Her daughter was a captive of King Edward I. He puts her in a convent to be raised and forces her to be a nun when she grows up. And so there are no direct descendants. There are cousins. There will be more Earls of Leicester, but none direct descendants of Simon de Montfort. Historians puzzle over Simon. British historians in particular have trouble because he's so improbably a voice for the people. He's wealthy. He has very little communication with them, and yet he is so fervently for their participation. The British do not have the founding fathers we have. We have that whole group of people who are equally improbable. And so we have a little less trouble understanding someone who can walk that far from his background. And so when you read British history, they talk about Simon a lot. And some of them are very pro-Simon. They just celebrate what he did. Others say, yeah, but you know, he was arrogant, and he was a little dictatorial. He probably would have been a tyrant had he lived. Well, you know, I might be a tyrant if I live to be 110, but the odds are I'm not going to, so you can't really say that. But you see a lot of that really difficulty in some English historians trying to put together his background with his actions. But I really think he fits a Mark Twain quote beautifully, for at least for us. Mark Twain once said, "Truth is stranger than fiction." But it is because fiction is obliged to stick to the possibilities. Truth is not. Okay, next week, ladies and gentlemen, the Black Plague arrives. We have a peasants' revolt, a royal coup. And in our spare time, the English army will invade France for a change. See you then.